Shus by Rechami. Entire island that has come together today. When we think of a Yom HaDin, we think, I like to think about it, but when we think about Lachamei of Esrim coming to a Yom HaDin, there are two images that can come to mind. One is an image of a Yom HaDin on mitzvahs bein adam lamakom. A mitzvah that have to be between a human being and God. And the other has to do with mitzvahs bein adam lachaveiro. The yeshiva world, we think very often about the concept of having a bechina, a feher, on the Yom HaDin. I think any of us, when we think about a bechina on the Yom HaDin, our hair, we shudder, we're frightened. What's Rabbi Nishan going to test us on? It's a scary thought. On the other hand, when we think about mitzvahs bein adam lachaveiro, when we think about HaKadosh Baruch Hu judging us on mitzvahs that are between a man and fellow man, I think we're a little more comfortable. A little more comfortable. After all, we all behave in nice ways, we're nice people. Like you say, we're a mensch. And I think we're a lot less frightened about a Yom HaDin on Beinadu L'Chaveira than we are on Beinadu L'Mavu. It's a fundamental error that has to do with our understanding of Beinadu L'Chaveira. The mitzvahs Beinadu L'Chaveira, the way the Torah requires it, are way, way beyond what we do. Our concepts of Beinadu L'Chaveira have to do with menschlichkeit, being kind, being nice, and that just scratches the surface of what the Torah is mechayiv. The chiyuvim of the Torah in Adam Lachaveira, the way one yid is supposed to treat another yid, go way, way beyond what we sitting in an armchair think is quote unquote menschlichkeit. And I might say that a Yom HaDin on Adam Lachaveira is the more frightening one. Torah is mechayiv, without exception, that if another yid who's 70 years old walks into a room, a person is obligated to stand up. It's a chiyuv in the Torah that's not a secret. Everybody knows. And they say v'atokom. Yet, you go to a wedding, somehow when chas and kala come in, people have this notion of standing up. If elderly grandparents are walking down the aisle, you don't see anybody stand up. It's a chiyuv ha-Torah that's just widely ignored. And these are things that happen every day. The chiyuv of kavod is someone who's older. At the age of 70 is al pidin. At the age of 60, al pi arizal is an obligation to get up. And that has nothing to do with the person being a talmid chacham. I think our notion of the chiyuvim of Bein Adam L'Chaveira is very American, very not Torah-dic. We don't see it as an obligation that rests on our shoulders, oil out Savare. The Torah is given, Yitzislav Lehenisnim, Nuel on oil out Savare. It's placed as a yoke on our neck, a job to do, something you have to roll up your sleeves and be conscious of and go out and do. We don't see Bein Adam L'Chaveira that way in many, many areas of Bein Adam L'Chaveira. When it comes to Kibbutz Ava'im, it's a little tricky to speak. Because on the one hand, those who have to give Kibbutz Ava'im have to be told the depth of their obligation. And on the other hand, those who are the receiving end of Kibbutz Ava'im should probably not be trained to expect it. The fact remains that the obligations of Kibbutz Ava'im are way beyond the notions, the thoughts that we have as Americans. It has nothing to do with fairness. It has nothing to do with menschlichkeit. If a parent is, even objectively, if a parent doesn't behave menschlich, there's still a chiyuv of Kibbutz Ava'im. The chiyuv remains the same. And when there are difficulties, the chiyuv remains the same. It's more than that. the whole basis of Yadus is Messiah. The whole basis of Yadus is passing down from generation to generation. Tzaddik writes, there are 12 paths in serving Hashem. This is a concept which comes from the Rishayim. And each one of the Shvatim represents one of those paths. We find that Menashe and Ephraim are Shvatim. Menashe takes over for Yosef, his father. And Ephraim is, so to speak, the Eretz Shevet, the place of Levi. Tzaddik says that Ephraim's path in serving Hashem is the path of a grandparent and a grandchild. A parent and a child, as at Mis Nefesh, when you raise a child, there's friction between parent and child, there are worries. There's another path, that of a grandparent that's Mechazik and Mechanach, a grandchild. Yaakov Avinu never worried about raising Ephraim. He didn't know Ephraim existed as a boy. He met him later. He had only nachas from him from the day he met him. Ephraim was the chavrusa of Yaakov Avinu. And that's the easiest path in all the paths of serving Hashem, is the path of the hashpa, the influence of a grandparent on a grandchild. But that has to be nurtured. And it has to be nurtured from both ends. When children are in a position to care for elderly parents, it's an opportunity for a mitzvah that doesn't last forever. It's an opportunity not only for a schus for yourself, but to bring a positive hashpa into the home. It should be seen as this hallmark of Yiddishkeit. I must tell you that my father-in-law, should live and be well, came into this line only through chesed. Originally, from spending many, many hours as a volunteer in the emergency room of the hospital helping people. And later, when his own father-in-law became quite ill, had a disease which left him unable to respond, unable to speak. And they live in a two-family home. And the downstairs apartment, which had been rented out, was vacated. And Alizeda lived there the last years of his life in a condition where he was unable to move, unable to speak. We don't know how much he was able to understand, but he was cared for. And from that experience came the thought, the notion that there has to be a group of companies, of people, that service the firm community, that offer them, that know what the firm community needs, and that can go out and help the firm community. We live in a Medina Shel Chesed, a country which provides a lot of benefits. But it's also a little meshuga, the idea that you have to be able to fill out the papers the right way. If you fill out papers one way, what you do is legal. If you do it a different way, what you do is illegal. You're not eligible. You're stealing. And the nuances of that are, I think, the understanding of those nuances are coming together here today, and the introduction of those ideas in which I'm not an expert, but which I hope you'll hear about. What I mean to offer to you is this thought, the opportunity with all the difficulties of bringing a parent or a parent-in-law into a home should be seen as an opportunity for a key of mitzvah gadol miyayim. If one of the Gedalei Adar from Eretz Yisrael was coming to America and they asked you to house him, you'd be happy. You'd clean out the house, and you'd have him live in your house for a while. Your obligations to a parent or to a parent-in-law are bigger than that. The sky is bigger than that. The whole notion is more than that. And it's an opportunity to bring bracha into our homes. I recently started learning Iyayv. And at the same time, I'm learning Bava Basra in Yeshiva. Before Pesach, we finished Perek HaShutfin. The last few blot are Agadah to Gemara, and we finished it, so that after Pesach, we started Vayachvar. There's a blot regarding Eiv. You're all familiar with the fact that Eiv suffered terribly, and then debated why human beings suffer. Very strange thing in the Gemara is the Shita of Rava. Rava consistently, if I may use the expression, beats up on Eiv. When a pasuk could be translated two ways, Rava translates it that Eiv made a mistake. The pasuk says, "Lechata Eiv b'sfasach." Eiv never said anything incorrect. So Rabbah translates, Lechata b'sfasav, ava b'li b'chata. He touches it, no, but in his heart, he said the wrong thing. Rabbah says, Kofar Eiv b'tchias ha-mesim. He touches a pasuk in a way that pushes Eiv into the category of kfira. Although we know at the end of the story, Eiv is seen as a tzaddik. Why does Rabbah look to translate psukim l'grayusa? The answer lies in the final member of Rava regarding Eiv. At the end of the day, when Eiv, as you know, at the end, is blessed once again, Rava says the lesson is, Mikan, She'ein Adam Nitfas Al Tzara. From here we see Eiv is teaching us that when you have a man that says the wrong thing, as Rava translates the Pesukim, he says things that are improper. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, Ein Adam Nitfas Al Tzarei. When a person is in pain and he says something wrong, you cut him some slack. We're understanding of it. You say it's okay. It's an attitude that people who have elderly parents in their homes have to understand. By and large, these are people who are productive, active, people who are matzliach in everything they did. And here they are now feeble, very often unable to take care of themselves, in a poor situation. And then children complain that it's difficult to have the elderly parents at home. They say the wrong thing, they're too demanding, they get angry easily, they're frustrated easily. Mikan she'ein adam nitfas al tzarei, be understanding. The understanding that an elderly person who is in a condition from which she has no reasonable hope to recover, and in a condition which is frustrating on a daily, minute-by-minute basis, the children to understand and have the right attitude, the attitude of kavod, the attitude of respect to parents, that brings bracha into a home. On the parent side, there's an obligation as well. Chazal make much over the idea of leaving an inheritance. There was an incident where a Yid left a will, and he wrote in the will that he leaves all his money to whatever is the best place for it to go. That's what he wrote in his will. Rabbi Kiva Eger was asked to decide where the money should go. And Kiva Eger wrote a tshuva in which he writes, how do I decide where's the best place for the money to go? Today somebody would have said to my yeshiva. Rabbi Kiva Eger said, what's the best place for the money to go? The Torah says, to the Urshim, to those who inherit. Chazal make much over an obligation to leave the Yerusha properly, not to be Mishana Leben Ben Abonim. Rules, Yeshneichlim is the second largest perek in Shas about Yerusha. And the perek which follows, Mishaneis, further talks about guidelines in Yerusha. A person who comes to these years has to be prepared financially, to do what has to be done, to protect. He worked all his life, not for the money to go to the benefit of Uncle Sam, Not that we have anything against Uncle Sam. But the Torah says that that's not where it should go. Common sense says that that's a black hole. Preparing is vital. It doesn't mean you have to give away all your money to your children while you're still alive. But it means that there has to be some common sense, some type of common sense approach as to how to prepare for the eventuality. We hope we should all be Marech Yamim. We say, Amei Ve'esrim all the time. Amei Ve'esrim carries with it very often frailty. One really has to be prepared. Tachana is everything. Yishatarach Be'er Shabbos, Yechel B'Shabbos. Eilam Hazeh is a place of preparation. But the idea that a person should prepare for difficulty when he's still healthy and strong is the idea, I think, that is the basis of the gathering here today. There are seven mashkim in the Torah. The Torah has seven liquids which are defined in halachic terms as mashke. Many of us are familiar with this idea from the Gemara's concept of machshir etumah. The seven liquids are yad, shachat, dam. Yayim, dam, shemen, cholov, vash, tau, and mayim. These are the seven mashkin that are in the Torah. There are seven yamim Torah. In addition to the three Yamim Tovim, Tishrei, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and Sukkos, we have Pesach and Shavuos, Hanukkah, and Purim. It's interesting that every Yom Tov corresponds to one of the Mashkin, without a dray or a twist, Pashup. Pashup Shah. Which Yom Tov is Shemen? We all know. Oil is Hanukkah. Yayin is Purim. Honey, it's Rosh Hashanah. We bench Tau on Pesach. Mayim, we bench Geshem on Sukkos. Yom Kippur, as we say in our Tefillah and Filazaka, we ask that the Miyut Hadam of Yom Kippur should be a Kapara like Zrikas Hadam. Of course, the one which remains is milk, which corresponds to Shavuos. How does it correspond to Shavuos? Well, the only cheesecake on Shavuos, the cooking of the Torah, it seems. Milachix on Shavuos. The truth is, of all seven, Milachix on Shavuos is the biggest milachix. Everything else fits well. Every Yom Tov fits to that liquid perfectly. Milk on Shavuos, well, it's a Ramah. The Sfarim community never heard of it until they got to the United States. How does milk have to do with Shavuos? When we talk about Nata Taira, Shir Hashirim, we say, Ki Taivim Deidecha Miyayim. We talk about this, receiving the Taira as something that comes to us with our mother's milk. As you know, Moshe Rabbeinu, who gave the Taira, could not nurse from an Egyptian woman, but only from the milk of a Jewish woman. The idea of Cholav in Shavuos may well be tied not only to the meaning of Milachix, but to the idea that Torah is Messiah, mother's milk. Yiddishkeit is Messiah, one's mother's milk. We express ourselves always as Yiddishkeit being from generation to generation. And that's why from the Yidden, Orthodox Jews, like no one else, see it as a consistent job in our lives to provide for our children. We do have a community that has so many young married couples being supported by parents. And on the other end, the parents to be on the receiving end as well, the children to see that that link in the Messiah is kept up by appreciating the Kesher, appreciating that bond, and then making it stick. Rabbeinu Bachya says that if you're afraid that your husband is spending too much time on Kibbutz Av HaEim, And back in Yisroel says, you should know, that's why it says in the Aseres Adibris L'man Yarichun Yamecha. Yish Baruch Hu tells the spouse, the wife whose husband is spending too much time with the parents, or the husband who feels his wife is spending too much time, L'man Yarichun Yamecha, don't worry, you're not losing any time. You'll get the time back. That's why Yarichus Yamin is the star. Keep it out of. So as we come together today, this is an Asifa gathering, really to be prepared for a Kiyum HaMitzvah, not just a Kiyum HaMitzvah, but a Kiyum, a very special mitzvah, a mitzvah which is always tied to stress. We want to be able to take care of ourselves all our lives, God willing. And we want for our parents to be able to take care of themselves. And it's a b'di'evit situation. It's not what we prefer when these needs come forward. But a smart person, a firm person, prepares for these eventualities, and that's why we're here today. I'd like to thank you all for being here. I hope that the schluss of preparing for these eventualities, and the Shabbos give us the schluss, we should have strength and vigor, we should have energy all our lives into our older age. Baruch Hu should give us bracha and hatzlacha. If there's a requirement from heaven to have some agvas nefesh in old age, let's instead take it as a preparation. Agvas nefesh, the decisions that have to be made in preparation, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu should accept that and claim the real thing. HaKadosh Baruch Hu grant us all arichus yamim, to be able to dance towards Mashiach. Son, father, grandfather, great-grandfather, all dancing together. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, first I'd like to start off by thanking Revival. We did this program in Bar Park, as Yitzhak mentioned. It was a super success. It is a program, like you mentioned, that's done. It's for Tayelas of the Rabbim, for Tayelas of everyone that's here. As Yitzhak mentioned, yes, we do make a living out of doing this, but I can tell you, the reason we started Senior Care is very much in line with the reason that the Bible started, and that is we saw the tremendous need that's out there. I can't tell you how often we get phone calls from friends of ours, our own relatives, what should I do, I'm in a situation. And that's how Senior Care began. It began actually as a chesed as well. We started helping a few people, and the next thing you know, it just came crashing down. And I can tell you we deal kind of her non-stop, day in, day out, with families that come down, and it's unfortunate that right now we're at the tip of the iceberg. That's how many people could utilize the services that we provide. And I'll tie it all in because we really work very closely, hand in hand, with the Revivals and other, we spoke about the assisted livings, the nursing homes, it all ties in, it's one big community. So first of all, I'd like to thank Mary Spitzer, thank the Zakhans for having us tonight. As mentioned, Penny Heller, of my staff is here, will be available afterwards also to answer questions. Shmuel Solomon is here as well. We started the symposium tonight. Can you afford to get old? Are you prepared if illness strikes? And I can tell you, Yitzhak just mentioned long-term care. The reality is, it's an unfortunate situation. Nobody, I shouldn't say nobody, but a very, very small percentage of people prepare for what actually happens once someone gets ill. And it's an unfortunate thing, and I think that as time goes on, people unfortunately are going to see what's going on, and they're going to look for alternatives such as long-term care. But for the interim, right now we're discussing Medicaid. So what is Medicaid? We'll go into the details of Medicaid, what you can get from Medicaid, and possibly what the drawbacks are to Medicaid. But the reality is, let's take the typical situation we deal with on a daily basis. Yitzhak had mentioned a few of the phone calls that he gets. And we get the same type of phone calls. All of a sudden, it's a phone call from someone that we know. And I tell you, my cell phone sometimes goes off late at night, and I don't give out my cell phone. I try not to answer phone calls at night. I'm not a doctor. I don't deal with emergencies. But to the families that have someone who's a loved one in the hospital, whatever the case may be, to them, it's an emergency. And what happens is you get thrown into a very vicious world known as healthcare. People think, I have my health insurance. I got my GHI. I got my Oxford. The elderly have Medicare. Very often they opted for one of these Cadillacs, or so they think. The HMOs, which are probably the worst thing to go into if you want good care. It's too. I got an HMO, Medicare, Oxford, whatever it may be, and I'm not using one particular company. And then they get thrown into a situation, something happens to the loved one. And the person's in a hospital. They think the hospital's going to take them and keep them forever, and they find out the reality is, in a very short period of time, that hospital wants you out the door. They will tell you anything to get you out. They'll tell you your covenant. As I'm looking in the crowd and I'm seeing the smiles, I don't make this stuff up. I don't look to scare people. I just like to bring out the facts to people so people know what they're dealing with. The facts are, you don't stay in a hospital. I don't care if you need rehabilitation, if you need a ventilator care, you need dialysis care, traumatic brain injury, you name it. You're not staying in that hospital unless you're literally so sick that you could stay there. The hospitals today send you out. Where am I going? Well, they give you an option. You can go home. You mentioned that's a tremendously viable option. A viable, you're more than happy to take care of your loved one at home. They need skilled care. Person's on a ventilator. Person needs dialysis. It's just not a reality. Take that patient home. The person needs rehabilitation. You could go home, not going to get the rehabilitation that you can get in a skilled care facility. So people think, nursing homes, I promised my parents I'm never going to put my mother into a nursing home, never going to put my father into a nursing home. Go into the nursing homes, ask them who's in the nursing homes today. I started in this business, and it's hard to believe, in 1987. I was running a 200-bed nursing home. Our nursing home was doing approximately 80 admissions a year. The same 200-bed nursing home today is doing 300 admissions in and out. And that's not an aggressive facility. The facility is doing 800-900 admissions a year. Small facilities. Because all these people that thought they're staying in the hospitals, because years ago their mother was actually taken care of in the hospital, today you get shipped out, you're no longer staying in the hospital, you're going to the nursing homes. And of course, you look at the nursing homes, no more nursing homes. They're all for rehabilitation centers. The reason is because that's where the rehabilitation is getting done. It's getting done in the nursing home. And now we're faced with a tremendous dilemma. Because I thought that I'm covered. I have my Oxford. I have my Medicare. What more do I need? So we go ahead and we find out that in a nursing home, you're covered if you have Medicare for 20 days in full. Beyond that, there's a $128 co-payment that kicks in day 21 to day 100. Day 100 is the maximum you're going to get in a nursing home, 100 days. And that's only if you stay skilled care as defined by the Medicare program. Now what? Parent has assets. Am I eligible for Medicaid? Okay, I have too much money. I'll go home, it's cheaper. Now it becomes a financial decision. What's the best thing for parent? Not necessarily, we don't necessarily look at that. Right now, all of a sudden, we're looking at the money. And we have this daily. People coming to the office saying, you know, my father's on a ventilator, could I take him home? You take him home, you may kill him. But the reality is that that's what they're looking at. They're saying, the nursing home is costing, I just throw it out. Does anyone have any idea what a nursing home costs today?
$350
is probably the lowest rate you're going to get. Does anyone have any idea what a nursing home costs for a ventilator bed a day? Probably $825, $850 a day. I had a phone call today, someone was on dialysis and a vent. Dialysis is $350 a day, the vent is $8.25 a day. Combine it, that's what the rate is, $1,100 a day. How are we affording to pay for this? So, what ends up happening, and that's, we're here tonight to explore what Medicaid would pay for, and obviously we're going to talk a tremendous amount about home care, we're going to talk about nursing home care, as time allows, we'll try to get it as much as we can. Let's talk about Medicaid. There are three different types of Medicaid. One is called community coverage without long-term care, and basically what that is, it's a Medicaid. It's a very lousy Medicaid. Just about anyone in this room could do this Medicaid. You send a letter to Medicaid attesting to the fact that we have no assets, and we'll get Medicaid. Generally good for about 30 days, and that's the end of it. It's not really an option for most of the people sitting in this room, or anyone who needs care. It's not really an option. It's very limited. Next level of care is called community coverage with community-based long-term care. And that's what we're here to talk about tonight primarily, and that's with volume. Someone who needs that level of care that's to take care of a loved one in the house, in the community setting. They're going to have someone taken care of, possibly in a shalom manner, where a person has assisted living. It's not going to pay for the room and board, but it'll pay for someone to take care of an aide and shalom, as an example. It may pay for some of the assisted livings out there that do accept Medicaid, although they're very few and far between. So that's the second one that we could speak about. And the third covered service is called All Medicaid, which is all covered services that includes our nursing home. So let's start with the first thing. Rabbi Spitzer mentioned before, we have a lot of people that get that call Revival, and I can tell you they call us as well. Generally, when they come down to us, which Rabbi Spitzer announced, it stated before, as a bad mistake, someone gave them advice. Usually it's the fellow in shul who doesn't know anything, who thinks he knows because he went through it with his mother. And all of a sudden they gave the advice. Sometimes they're right, but 99% of the time they're wrong. There are people out there that represent themselves as being helpful to the community or helpful as attorneys or whatever it is and don't really know long-term care. They're a real estate attorney and they're giving advice on long-term care, which is fine if they understand it. But if they don't understand that they're giving very poor advice, very often selling trusts or whatever it is, that could be detrimental. And I can tell you, we have people, and there's some of them sitting here in the audience, that have come to our office, and I promise you, they go out crying to us. I can't believe I went to this person, I spent $10,000 on this trust, that trust, and it turns out it was the worst thing for me. Forget the money that I spent. I want to undo it, but I can't undo it because the trust was done improperly, incorrectly, and it's irrevocable. So the bad advice that people are getting, the mistakes they're making, could be extremely, extremely costly. So the question is, how do I do this right? We have a checklist. We'll go over the checklist after. I love checklists on everyone's chair. You'll be able to go through it. But let's go through some of the basic information before we go through the checklist. We'll try to go through the checklist later. For Medicaid purposes, there are two things that we have to look at. One is something called an asset, and one is something called an income. What is an asset? What is an income? And that's really what Medicaid is going to look at. Number one, let's go through some of the assets. I have bank accounts, and you'll see it listed on the second page of the checklist. You'll have all the financial information there. Any kind of bank account, savings accounts, checking accounts, CDs, you name it, that's an asset. Stocks and bonds. I have stocks. What is the value of the stocks? What is the value of the bonds? That is an asset. I have life insurance. People don't realize this. If they have a life insurance policy, life insurance very often has a cash value. That cash value is considered to be part of your assets. Sometimes people have large amounts of cash value and don't even realize this. They have no money. They have $80,000 sitting in a cash value of a life insurance policy. That is considered to be an asset for Medicaid. The big word, I own my house. What do I do with the house? That's an asset. I have other investments. I have properties. People go ahead and invest into things. They'll get a K-1 at the end of the year. They don't even know what they got. And all of a sudden, yeah, I get a few dollars every month, but they don't realize that they own part of a building. That building is an asset. So those are assets. Now let's look at the income. What is an income of somebody? The incomes are Social Security checks. People think, well, I got Social Security. That's what I live on. Medicaid looks at that as your income. It's an income. Whatever your Social Security amount is. Pensions. People get wages. Sometimes the spouse, we'll talk about spouses' cases in a minute. Spouse gets a wage. Patient still gets a wage. Rental income. Person has a house. Person has an investment. Whatever it may be, they rent out the second floor. The rental income is looked at as an income. Sometimes someone was working. They went out of workers' compensation. Workers' compensation comes in every 2 weeks. That's an income. I have an asset. The asset gives dividends. Medicaid will look at those dividends, even if it's a few dollars, and that's part of what they consider to be income. So here we have the assets, we have the income. Now let's try to understand the differences between the assets and the income, how it plays a role into these two types of Medicaid. The good news is that the amount of assets that a person is allowed to have actually just went up. First time I'm saying it in public, we just got the memo on Friday. So until Friday, the asset amount that a person could have. Now again, we just listed out six different types of assets. The total value, let's keep the house out of the picture, the total value of all the other assets was able to be, for an individual, $4,350. So if you wanted to be poor, you had to have less than $4,350. The good news is that number just went up. Effective April 1st, the number now is $13,050. Hot off the press. Medicaid doesn't even know how to deal with this yet because it just came out. They didn't give the memos on how to deal with it. But let's assume we now went up to $13,050. I hate to break it to too many people, but $13,050 is a nice amount of money, but it doesn't make you too rich. So, you have over $13,050, you're not entitled to Medicaid. One of the things that we deal with on a daily basis is to help people bring those assets down to levels that will allow you to apply and be eligible for Medicaid. You're also entitled to, above the $13,050, you're also entitled to a burial account. And so I've mentioned burial, and it is very important. You should throw all these things in. It is part of our consultation. If you look on the form, we actually utilize these forms for consultations. It's something no one likes to talk about. But I'll tell you what I told my own parents. My mother's actually sitting here. I told them, we have to talk about it once. And that's it. But it has to be discussed. You want to buy long-term care? Buy long-term care. Pay the check once a year. Finished. It's done. It's over. If you fit into that category, get over it. Take care of your need. Buy your long-term care. Buy your burial. Discuss it with your children. They should know what's going on. I can't tell you. You took mention a story. I had a story with someone who deals with funerals. That's the person's front office it was. The man was 95 years old. I went down with his children to speak to the father. And I turned to him and I said, okay, I'm sure your burial's taken care of. The kids had no idea where the father wanted to be buried. The man was 95 years old and dying. When are the children going to wake up to tell, when are the parents going to wake up to tell the children? Don't you want to go where your parents, where you want to go, not where your children think you want to go? It's important that the children know what's going on. The children have to know what's going on, because otherwise when something happens, and it happens every single day in our office, the children don't know anything. They have no idea where the assets are. They have no idea if they are assets. They have no idea if they are monies. And I'll throw in a line here, it's important. Powers of attorneys. Kids all the time come into the office. My parent is incapacitated. They can't make decisions. I don't know anything. I went through the documents that I saw in the drawer. There's some money in the accounts. Good, I want to get my mother onto Medicaid. Transfer the assets, you get them onto Medicaid. I can't transfer the assets. I don't have power of attorneys. I can't do anything. Yes, there's no question about it. If you give your child a power of attorney, it can go wipe out your accounts. Find a child that you trust. Lock it up in the safe. I don't know what you got to do. But by going ahead and not doing anything, what ends up happening is when and if you need the care, you're not going to get it simply because no one's able to access the accounts. And isn't that a shame? It's just a shame that someone can't get the care they want because they were holding it back. You have to trust your children because they're the ones that are going to be there to take care of you, unfortunately, if it ever is needed. And we see it all the time. And don't think, I hate to say this, but don't think it only happens to old people. I'm dealing with a case now of a 30-year-old lady. I'm dealing with a case with a 50, 60, we deal with this constantly. We had a case in the office today, the husband is 56, the wife is 62. They're both never very, very, very sick. And it happened like this overnight. No planning, no nothing. It doesn't only happen to the elderly, it happens to everybody. You have to have some kind of plan in place. So let's talk about some of the things that we're talking about. We spoke about the assets. What about the income? How much income am I entitled to keep? If you're in a community setting, the maximum income that a single person could keep is $725 a month. So we have all these income, that whole list of income, so security checks, pensions, etc. $725. How many times have I heard, I'm not eligible for Medicaid because my income is too high? It is such a baloney story. It's out there, everyone is talking about it. It's so incorrect, and it's hurt so many people. We did a thing in Borough Park a couple months ago. a lady comes over to us, and this is not an exaggeration, it hurt us. I paid $80,000 to date out of pocket to a home care agency because I was told I'm not eligible for Medicaid because my income is too high. How much is your income? $400 a month above what's allowed. Isn't that a shame? So we're sitting over here, and I'm telling you, I said this before, yes, we're doing it because we make a living. I'm telling you, I do this on a daily basis. I know we are helping people out every single day. There are people that need the care. There's so much misinformation out there. Why? It's not that difficult to get onto Medicaid. And if there's one thing that you're going to walk out of here tonight with, I'm going to tell you one thing and I'll reiterate it again later. The type of relationship that we have with Revival is a very simple relationship. It is so easy to qualify for home care Medicaid. Today is May 27th. If you come over to me today and I have $100,000 in the bank account or $1 million in the bank account, and I transfer out those assets today, tomorrow, or any time this week before June 1st, I'm eligible for home care Medicaid June 1st. It's as simple as that. I know I made it simple. I know there's tax ramifications. We spoke before, not everyone's, Medicaid doesn't work for everyone. I got a guy that's worth $10 million. Don't transfer the assets. But most of the people that we talk to, and I'd say it's 99.5%, they're eligible for Medicaid, they could get Medicaid, and it's a shame that they're not getting the care when they need it, simply because they're too scared to go ahead and transfer the assets, they're too scared to go speak to someone who may help them. They heard from somebody that I can't get onto Medicaid because that person is the big mofo down because their mother didn't get Medicaid for whatever reason. It's just such a shame. There are people like ourselves, and again, yes, we're doing it to make a living, isn't it? We're here to help you. Revival is here to help you. What we're doing is very simple. We help you transfer the assets. We will explain to you at the time that we transfer the assets how it will affect a nursing home case should you need a nursing home. And we'll speak about that for a few minutes. But more importantly, we transfer out the assets anytime in the month of May, June 1st, Revival will be there to take care of your mother, father, whoever it may be. It's as simple as that. We don't wait until Medicaid gets approved. Revival will take our pending case. The second we go ahead and give the case to Martin, and we tell Martin it's a good case, Martin will go ahead and say it's okay for Revival to come and give your mother, father, whoever it is, loved one, the hours that you need. Now, I'm not going to tell you you're going to get 12 hours, 24 hours. That's not my decision. That's Revival's decision how many hours they could possibly give you based on the laws of Medicaid as far as the skill needs that they have to go by. But the reality is when somebody needs that care, the care is there for them, not when the Medicaid application comes through in 3 months or 2 months. Our applications typically take about 45 days. It's there for you when you need it, when the person is coming out of the hospital. So let's go with some good news tonight. We're talking about what possibly could be a depressing topic. Let's talk about some good news. The good news is something happened to a loved one. They're in that hospital. They're home, whatever the case. They're in the nursing home, they're in the Shalom Manor, wherever they may be. You need care. You do this right, the care could come immediately. When I say immediately, literally the month after you make the transfers. If someone falls asleep at the wheel and they don't do the transfers this week in May, and they do the transfers June 1st, they're not eligible until July 1st. It's the month after you've made your transfers. So it's, you came here for nothing else other than this one line, it's worth coming here. And I'm telling you, this is not something we're on tape. I'm not telling you something that's a knavish shtick. I'm telling you the way the Medicaid rules and regulations are. I don't make the regulations, I don't make the rules. We learned the rules and we follow them. The other thing I'd like to tell you is there's no two people in this room that have the same situation. We happen to file thousands of Medicaid applications a year. There's no two applications that go in alike. They have similar concepts. There's no two people that are alike. Everyone has a unique situation. I tell people, call me all the time, you know, I have this one question. Can I ask you this one question?
and I laugh every time I get that phone call. It's like calling a doctor. My foot hurts. What is wrong with my foot? I may guess right, I may guess wrong. Because 50% of the time I'll guess right. But the reality is, very often, it's not that one question that you think you have. It's by going over the checklist and understanding Medicaid rules to figure out what works in my particular situation. And again, whatever we discussed at this point is all for home care, not for nursing home. So we'll go into some other things as quickly as we can go. Let's go over some of the... Well, let's talk about for a second... let's talk about the nursing homes. Okay, so we spoke about home care. It's easy to get onto Medicaid for home care. Effective February 8th of 2006, there were new rules that were put into effect for Medicaid. Those new rules changed the whole way that we deal with nursing home cases. Basically, until that point, and I'll try to give this over as easy and as simple as I can, let's go prior rules, and we can try to explain the new rules. Under the prior rules, if a transfer was done, a transfer of assets that was done for Medicaid in a nursing home, they would take the average cost of care in a nursing home, divide it by the amount that was transferred, and come up with a period of ineligibility. So let's use some examples here. Everyone heard there's a 3-year look-back period for Medicaid. Again, we hear this all the time. Everyone thinks it has to do with community. We already, I think, came out very clearly. It's not a community issue. It's a nursing home issue only. February 8th of 06, the laws changed. The look-back period is going to go up to 5 years. The transfer is done after February 8th of 06. So if someone did transfers prior to February 8th of 06, it goes by the old rules. After February 8th, 06, it goes by the new rules. Under the old rules, there's a 3-year look-back period. So if I was to apply to Medicaid today, May of 08, I have to give all my bank statements from May of 05 to May of 08. Within those 3 years that I had to give documentation, Medicaid is going to look, were there transfers of assets? And we'll talk a second about other issues, but let's throw it in right now. People tell me all the time, well, I'm entitled to give $12,000 a year as gifts. Medicaid says you're entitled to give it for an IRS, not for Medicaid. So if you transferred and gifted out to your kids over the last 3 years, Medicaid will subject that to a penalty period. Again, that doesn't mean you're not eligible for nursing home Medicaid. That means we have to look further. There's a 3-year window. We gave the bank statements. January of 06, which is in that 3-year window, which is prior to February of 06, I transferred $100,000. I gifted it. I'm going to tell Medicaid about it. I'm not hiding it. How is Medicaid going to look at that $10,000? $100,000. The answer is very simple. They take that $100,000 and divide it by that regional Medicaid's regional level for the cost of care in that region. There are 6 different regions in the state. Let's use New York City. The amount today is $10,123 a month. That's what Medicaid allows for the average...